Welcome to Grace Works. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Yes. Apostle Jacqueline Tisdale. We haven't been here in a few weeks, but hey, we're excited about what the Lord is yet doing. We still believe that grace works. Amen. When the enemy tried to fight us, tried to stop us, but we're still here. So we got a great show for you on today, and it's a show that's very dear to my heart. So we're going to discuss some serious issues on today. So I believe that God has a word for us. Amen. So if you know anybody who's gone through so much in their lives, who don't think they can overcome, this show is for them. Call a neighbor, call a friend, tell them that Grace Works is on and that God has a word for them. Amen. So we're going to call up today our very special guest. Amen. It's going to be one of my very own. She's true to my heart. Amen. So we're going to welcome my very own Minister Kelsey Parker. Come on. Have a seat. Amen. 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 So today we're going to discuss about how to overcome your past. We have so many people out there, and when the Lord really laid this on my heart, there was a lot of questions, even down to my own life, that sometimes you want to examine your life to make sure that you're healed. It's amazing that the body of Christ is so broken. We're preaching, but we're broken. We're prophesying, we're broken. And we want, God want us whole. He said, I came that you may have life and that you may have it abundantly. So God did not call for us to live a life of brokenness. Amen. When he came to make us whole. When Jesus told us it was finished, it was finished. So on today, we're going to talk about some different subjects. Amen. About being broken. Amen. But about being healed also. So today is a very, very special show. So we're gonna just jump on in there, and we're gonna introduce Kelsey on today. We want to thank God for her. Say hey to the audience, Kelsey.
Hi, guys. Hi.
So when we're dealing with grace, I believe that grace comes for the total person. We've dealt with a lot of issues on this show. We've dealt with it in relationship as far as marriages and a lot of things. We in healing in the body. But one of the things I really want to deal with is about being healed in the inner man. Amen. And about dealing with the things that we've overcome, that we've had to go through in life. Everybody got a story to tell. And if you are not able to go forward in your life and not able to receive all Christ has for you because you're so burdened down about who did what to you, this is the show for you on today. Amen. And so we're going to talk, Sister Kelsey, about her life. And I've watched her as her pastor. Not only as her pastor, but even as her auntie. I was there the day she was born. So, but I've watched her go through many things, and people have judged her life. But let me tell you something, another person's life, when you look at your own life, it ain't all peaches and cream, amen? So, but we have got to get to the point that we stop judging others, but it's time to reach down and help others get back up, amen? Amen. So that is what we're doing, that's what Word of Life is all about. I'm the pastor that says, hey, yeah, you may have done it, but that's not who you are. So we want to walk in what God called us to walk in, and we want to be who God called us to be. We may not be perfect, but the Bible said a righteous man falls seven times, but that man get back up again. Amen? So we want to just give Kelsey a few minutes. I just want you, her, to just talk about, you know, some of the things that she's encountered in this life. And to me, it's just about dealing with the person. It's about dealing with the person. So you know, we all got circumstances. We can all judge everything. But today, I want to hear her story. I believe she got a great story to tell. I believe this young lady's going to go to the nations. I believe she's our next Juanita Bynum. Amen? And I believe that her story is going to be so powerful that God is going to show that she is more than an overcomer. Amen? And I can sit with her on today because I'm the pastor that believes in her. Amen? Amen. It ain't nothing like somebody that really believes in you. Amen?
Amen.
So we're going to just ask Kelsey, just tell us a little bit about your life and your upbringing and your growing up and some of the disappointments that you had in your life.
Well, hey, I'm Kelsey Parker. And like she said, I've been through a lot. I've experienced a lot of things and a lot of things that I didn't want to experience, but you know, you don't have control over that. And the very first thing, like she said, God is big is big on relationships. So my very first thing was, I never seen a complete happy relationship, and it started in the home, as with my mom or daddy. I don't even know what their marriage was, to really tell you the truth, because I was young when they was together. But I can tell from experience, when they divorced, after that, that's when I really began my life journey as a child, because I had to go from home to another home. And it was me and my oldest brother, because we share both parents. And the thing is, I never had a bond between my father, and it was like that was something I yearned for or longed for. And at the same time, it was like when I tried to get that close, he'll push away. And it was like he never experienced that. I don't know what was in his childhood life, but it's like he never had that experience, because it seemed like anybody get close to him, he pushes them away. And then I felt like my mama betrayed me when I was a child, because I was like, well, why would she let me go through this, knowing that this man is like this? Because as I grew up, yeah, my mom and dad used to fight. It used to be worse. I mean, we used to, me and my brother used to get beat on. He come in the house drunk. He like, why the rugs on the floor? And we looking like, that's how it's supposed to be. The house is clean. And we get beat. I was pistol whipped in front of a retarded man. Yeah, I said it. I was pistol whipped. And just to see the things that my dad did, like, as a child, you never experienced. But that's why I always said to myself, I never want to be like my parents. Because at the same time, it's like I never seen something that was happy. It wasn't happy. I always wanted to be happy. And another thing I seen, that when my dad, he got angry, he didn't know how to talk it out. He was an action person. And I find myself, I was being that kind of person, because that's what I was used to seeing. And the thing is, I always used to tell myself, I'm not going to be that way. But the more I kept saying it, it's like my mind wasn't programmed to put the word in action. That's why when I posted something on Facebook, I said, you never know how powerful you is until you open your mouth. Mm-hmm. And I was like, well, my mind didn't line up to the words that I was saying, and I was, you know, tormented. And it's like I had a war going on, trying to be the good person, but not knowing that nobody's in the world is perfect. And I was trying to be perfect, not knowing that I'm going to make some falls. And when I made the fall, I fought myself because of the fall, but not knowing that that's just life. But the thing is, I got up to try to correct the falls, because not knowing I was going to eventually have a little one, which is my 5-year-old Shayla, before this one. And after that, I said, she can't see a life that I seen, because it was hard when your parents hold you in a, well, when your father hold you in a room and he see you, you see him doing the same thing that he did his mother, well, to your mother, to the next woman, but it went even further, like, as in holding you in between his legs, and he's stabbing blood juice just on you, and you just sitting there. And you don't know whether you going to live or she going to live, and all you see is ambulance. You don't even know what happened to her. But at the end, when everything come back, then you see that she lived on. But the thing is, when you able to take on something like that as a child, it messes with your mind, because mm-hmm. it messes with mine. Mm-hmm. Because all I see, when I get angry, I see blood. Mm. And the thing is, I never want to do that, and that's why I never want to fight or get into an altercation with someone, because all I see is blood. And I know I have, now I have two kids on the way, well, two on, you know, early life or whatever, not on the way, but early life. But and I don't want them to experience that. I don't want them to have that hate or heart towards somebody. Like if something just not said right or correct, that they have that blood sight, because it's not a good feeling, and it's something that I battle with daily. So now when I tried to get in a relationship with the first man, it was kind of tough, because I was rejected because of how his mother felt, because he was the only child. And then I knew what was wrong, because it was like, well, at first you weren't ready anyways. And then at the same time, when I found out I was receiving a child, my firstborn, that's when he came back and he asked again, but it wasn't serious still. It's just because he had a child on the way. And the thing is, but my heart was there. So at the same time, my heart began broken in that relationship. So it's like every man afterward had to pay for what this person did and then what my daddy did. So then at the same time, so I, like the Bible said, you can't put your trust in man because they'll fail you. But my thing was, I didn't receive that in my mind. I just received it when somebody said it. And the thing was, I had to understand what a real relationship was. And the only how I got to that point was when I really, like, cried out to the Lord and let him know, like, how can I live on without knowing how to be in relationship? And relationship is not just being with a person that you're going to spend the rest of your life with. It's even in your friends, your family and everything. And another thing about that is that hurts too, because it's like my family is so broken and you can't even get a relationship through them because they're looking at your lifestyle and they're looking at how you was brought up, and they have certain ones that they choose that, you know, they have this favorite. And the thing is, so it's like it made me feel I had no one to turn to. And then I said, if I did turn to somebody, they're going to judge me for what I did instead of try to help get answers to help me get out of that. And it just been hard. So it's like I stopped looking to God, and I was looking at his people, because I was like, well, if they call themselves Christians, how can they judge me? And I said, the Bible said, be not judged, so is he, and don't cast the first stone. But I was like, how can they do that when I'm looking at the same, I'm following the same path that they did, it's just a little different. And I had trouble receiving that. And I was like, well, it's like my eyes got off of him and got to looking at the things that was around me. And that's why I felt short, because I was looking at the things around me. And I said, well, my mama couldn't keep a relationship. I know I'm not going to be able to keep this one. And I was like, well, then I kept cutting up my words, because I was like, I don't want to be like her. But then I find myself being like her. And I said, well, I tell you what, the next time I'm not finna do that. So I got in another marriage. I got into that because my pastor, she came to me and she was like, this is your husband. God said this and this and this. And I stand strong in God. So I said, Lord, if you said it's this, then it got to be this. And then I got in it, but it's like, I just got in it. It's like I wasn't there. And it was like, because I was like, I'm blocking out everything. And I'm like, I can't do this. This, no. It's like, some days it's okay. Some days it's not. Some days it's like, we need to go ahead and do the 30-day marriage and get on that for free. And then it was like, no matter how you try. And it was like, it's like something was in the way. And I never could understand. But it made me think about all the other things, and I said, this is what's in the way. And then so I started holding myself closer to my child, because I was like, I went through so much. I want her to even feel love through me. Like, if she can't feel love through anyone else, I want her to feel love through me. So all my love went yielding to my child instead of yielding to my husband, and that was out of order, because you supposed to love your husband first, then your kids next. So I was already out of order. The whole thing was out of order. And it said, a house that's divided would not stand. And it doesn't mean like he going his separate way and this way. It means like, if I'm not with him 100%, it's not going to stand. And my love didn't go to him. It went towards my child, because I'm trying to hold her from having a life that I had. And I never knew how to live a life. But I was learning through my pastor and trying to get all the knowledge that I could. But at the same time, it was like nothing was really hitting the relationship, that, because it's like she was preaching on it, but the things I seen around me was totally different. But it was just the way I needed to be seeing myself, as in putting myself in that spot, as in not looking at others, because not knowing what they had going on. But still, I should have been paying attention when she was doing the teaching and really trying to transform my mind. But at the same time, it was like my mind was all messed up with total different things. And then I tried to do so much to get my mind off of it. I tried to go to school. I tried to go, you know, get all these other things. And not none of it was nothing I really wanted to do. I really wanted to be a math teacher because I love math. But it's like I couldn't stay focused because I said, well, I got disappointed when I graduated. My dad said, you graduate. That's all I went to school for, just to graduate so I can get my car. He didn't get it then. Then I graduated again from Cosmo, got my license. He still didn't get me a car. And then it's like when I come over and I was like, I'm just trying again, see what he get. And I was like, you know, he never stood to the plate and been a father for real. And it's like, how can you say you're a father to a child, but you never, you be there, but you're not there. And that's, it just went from there. So I start thinking like, well, if that's how a man is, then it's like, it made my mind think like, well, when Jesus said my relationship is going to be whole and it's not, then why it's not? So it made me start thinking like, I know God is not a man that he should lie. So it started making me saying like, God didn't say that then. Because I know he wouldn't lie because it's not working. But the thing is, it wasn't working because of the things I had held in me. It's like, it was there, but I didn't let it be. And the thing is, I put myself in the way instead of getting myself out the way. So it made me total a different person that I didn't want to be. Because it's like I became bitter and started hating. And just, you know, anybody came up to me and started saying stuff, I was like, well, is it working for you? You know, I cut them off real quick because it's like, it's easy for you to say. But when you're in this shoe that I'm in, then I want to see you say that then. But that's far as I got with that part.
All right. So it shows you that a lot of people, we look at our lives and we look at the things that we go through in life. And we judge our life by what we go through instead of by what Jesus has done. And even in the midst of everything that Kelsey has gone through, the one thing I can say concerning her, she never stopped coming to church. She never stopped. She was always there. She stayed under the covering of the Lord. And when we mess up, we feel like we got to run back out in the world and we got to do this. You may make mistakes, but it's about learning to get up. We've all been through something. We've all had some situations. My father had been incarcerated since I was 4 years old. I'm 45 now. So I could have blamed my dad for where I was in my life. I started getting molested at the age of 8. So what it shows us, it doesn't matter where you start at in life and the things that happen to you in life, but you can change your life. It don't have to end like that. You don't have to spend your whole life just being angry and being hurt and being all of these things. I was a very angry child. I was a very angry child. You can't tell it now, but if you talk to my mother, she would tell you I was very angry. My words were not good words. And I felt like because I had been molested and all of this had happened to me, I didn't feel like I could have whole relationships either. So I can understand what you were saying. And your life so much reminds me of mine because I know the abuse of then your father. Well, my father wasn't there. My father couldn't be there because of bad decisions he made. And that's what I want to say to fathers. It doesn't matter whether you pay child support or not. Be in your child's life. Don't just be there. Be there in there to let that child know that you love them. That is so important. The jail is full of people that was wondering, where was daddy? Where was daddy? And so this show can cover so many things and so much heartache and so much pain because of the stuff that you've allowed. Some of us have been raped. Some of us have been molested. Some of us have been abused. And it's amazing that a lot of times the person that was abused then become the abuser. And we become like the very people that we hated. And so we have to understand that Christ died for that. Christ died for that. He came that we can have a better life. That it, just because my daddy was like that didn't mean I want to be like that. Just because my mama was a certain way, I realized one day that I could be a better mother. I realized one day that I could be a better wife. I realized one day that I could be a better person. I'm going to tell you something. Everybody trying to be a great something. People want to be great pastors. They want to be great business people. They want to be great whatever in life. But I come to understand, if you just become a better person, it will reflect in all of the rest of your life. And just to deal with Kelsey and her life and being there firsthand, knowing the stuff that she's had to encounter and the stuff she's had to go through. But my message and her message is today, it ain't gotta stay like that. Just because it start out like that, and that's what we want people to know. I'm not looking at her situation. I'm looking at what Christ has already paid for. Christ has already paid for the holiness. I can walk in holiness today. I could blame my ex-husband for cheating. I could blame. It's so many people to blame. But one thing, God gave us a word a couple of weeks ago that no more excuses. No more excuses. So we have to deal with where we are and realize that Christ wants to give us something so much better. So much better. It can be, let me tell you something. Your life can be as great as you want it to be. Well, it's too late for me because of this. And because you don't understand. And you don't understand how it hurt. And yeah, I do understand. Because I'm the same woman that tried to commit suicide 3 times by the time she was 16 years old. But God wouldn't let me die. And the same way with Kelsey. I remember the times that she wanted to die and the times she thought about suicide. And let's just talk about the suicide part. Let's just talk about that part.
Well, I just felt like when I was in my, okay. As a child, I thought about suicide because I was molested too. And it had been going on for 2 years. And the person, he never said sorry. Whatever, and it's just like even as I got older, I used to look at this person like, you see me in front of you, you still ain't said sorry. And the thing is, like, it's like, how? And I used to be like, my mama, like, I used to think she didn't care because I was like, now, how can you not know a child that always used to be scared of the dark, always crying, and then I get quiet for some reason? And I was like, she always normally used to come in the room check, but she be done did her little checks around, but I still used to be in there crying sometimes and stuff like that. But and it hurted me because it was like nothing I could do because the person told me if I told, he was going to kill me and my family. So it was like, it was something I had to hold for 2 years of being that and being that till finally he got caught. And that's when I used to be like, how can you not know? Like, and then I felt like she still didn't care because she stayed with the man, father still. And it just kept going. And then when he got back out of jail, he told me he was going to get me again. And I was like, what? And I said, this can't be happening. So it made me build up hate towards his father too. So it was like when his father and my mother got into it, I used to fight him. I used to fight him off my mama. She used to fuss at me. I used to tell her she was stupid and all that. And I was like, you know what? I tell you what, I just wish I just died. Because it's like, y'all don't, it's like, I couldn't tell her what was really going on. But it was like, at the same sense, if I tell her, I'm going to die still. So it's like, I might as well go ahead and die. And then when I got older, because I was like, I can't keep a relationship. And I've been in 2 marriages. One is... It got a divorce. The other one I got in, then it's like it's in the making. But however it go, cause like I said, I ain't doing nothing else now. And I was like, Lord, how can I get 2 relationships? And then I said, when this person got mad at me, he didn't know how to handle it because he had things he couldn't release either. His mom passed, and it's like he was holding on so much, and it was like, if I'm his wife, he should be able to talk to me about those things, but he couldn't. So I felt like, I really don't have a relationship with you for real. And I was like, I can tell you some of mine, but you still won't understand. So it's like different positions that I can be held down when you're trying to do intimacy. It scares me because I have flashbacks. And I was like, Lord, how can I have these flashbacks? Like, why am I still flashbacking on something of a little child? And it made me like, no, I don't want none. Or whatever. Then this person didn't know how to take it because of the thing that I've been. It's like, it's not you, it's not you. And then they'd be like, well, you must got somebody else. No, it's not that. It just, I don't know why. It just, those things just pop up and then I try to shake it off like it's nothing. But I was like, well, Lord, I don't even know my purpose on life. I mean, in life. And I used to play around with it, tell everybody when they make me mad. I'd be like, what's your purpose in life? But the thing is, I didn't know my purpose in life. And I was like, if it's to keep going through things, I was like, Lord, when is it going to stop? When is it going to stop? And one time when I prayed that, he was like, when are you going to not allow it to happen? And I said, well, I'm not going to let it happen in my daughter's life. And then he was like, no, you got it wrong. I'm talking about in your life, period. And I was like, well, I said, I'm going to try it again. I tried and keep going. Then I was like, I told Pastor, I said, it's not working. I called my pastor, and man, the person got in an argument, and it was just getting bad and bad. And I was like, I can't do this. I can't do it. And I was like, she keep coming at me. God said this, God said that. And it's like, I'm trying to hold that in, but it's like my mind wouldn't let me. And I was like, I'm finna take these pills that I got. And just tell mom the note is under the mattress. And I had done wrote a note. I had done wrote everything out. I was gonna send my child to her father. But not knowing, ain't nobody gonna take care of your child better than you would.
That's right.
And I was like, well, at least I'm at one. I don't have two. At least I'm at one. And I was like, well, hopefully she'll have a better life with him, because I was like, this can't be my life. I can't keep going through this. Can't keep doing this and just, you know, messing up. And I said, I'll keep messing up. And I know she's looking. And I was like, I don't want her to see this kind of life. And I was like, is there anybody that can show her a better life than I can? So I was like, well, it seemed like her dad is just having a good old time, because it's been nobody but him and his mom. So I was like, you know what, bump it, let me get these pills. And I was going to take them. She was on her way. And then by the time he woke up, and he was like, what are you doing? Then I was like, I'm going to take these pills. I'm going to go. So holler at you. You have a good life. I'm sorry. I said, death done did us apart. And I just, you know, the devil had me just talking out my neck. And then finally, Pastor got there. He talked to me so much that I was talking to him, and it helped me from taking the pills. And that's when Pastor came up there, and she was trying to hold me and comfort me and try to, you know, help me out. But it's like, it still was a mind battle there. Like, no, this can't happen. And so all I did was, I was like, well, freak it. I can't make a relationship. I said, well, you know what? I'm just going to, you know, do me then. And so I started doing me, and then got caught up. Didn't care who it hurt. I went and moved in an apartment that me and my husband had them bought or whatever. And it was another guy. He needed help or whatever. So I was like, okay, whatever. You come in. And then I was like, well, I started resenting my husband, because I was like, man, I don't need nobody. It can just be me and my child or whatever. And then, like she said, it'd be me and mine and no more. And that's how it was. And I was like, well, then it started getting worse and worse, because he started coming. He was like, dang, what's going on? I was like, man, we just chilling. And then it was like everybody started saying what was happening wasn't happening. So then I said, well, we might as well make it happen. So I said, well, you want to help me have my marriage? Then the person said, yeah. And then so it went on. We started making a relationship, not knowing that his marriage could have been held on to then me interfering. But I didn't care, because I was trying to get out of mine. So I was being selfish, and I didn't care who it hurt. And so when it did hurt, then it was like when the wives started acting out and coming towards me, I was down for whatever. I was like, yeah, you cross this line, you know, it's whatever. But not knowing I'm the one did it and didn't care. So I was like, she had a right, but at the same time, she should have been woman enough to not even do that. But like I said, I understand, you never know who what she was going through at the time either, to even have the strength to be woman enough. And the thing is, I didn't care regardless, because all I was looking at, like, trying to get out of mind, because I said, my pastor said she ain't gonna do it, because she said, Lord said this, and she not finna put a hand in it. So I was like, well, you know what, you ain't putting your hand in it, I put my hand in it. So I started getting my researches. I didn't even ask him to help me. I said, hey, can you help me look up some stuff to get out of this? Because I said, because then me and him wasn't working. And then I knew it wasn't going to work, because I didn't like white boys. No offense, but I didn't like white boys. So then I was like, well, you know. And then so, you know, I was like, well, all that being said, I'm now having a child and still married. And it's not the father of the man that I'm married to. It's either the light-skinned person or another person, because I had a one-night stand before a funeral.
This is your girl, Pastor Jacqueline Tisdale. We just want to tell you about our show, Grace Works. Grace Works is about dealing with the real issues. I believe that a lot of times that we don't deal with life as it really is. We're so busy sugarcoating and not dealing with real issues, so people are not really getting delivered. My heart's desire is that God, people will walk in total wholeness, total healing, total freedom in this hour. And I believe that this is the year that God wants his people to be whole. So Grace Works is about the grace of God, his love for you. Don't you know that he loves you? He loves you so much that he died for you. But he didn't just die for you. When he died that you may have life and life more abundantly. I'm telling you, when he said it was finished, guess what? Everything you could ever go through, there's never an answer for no question that you will ever have in your life. There is never an answer for a problem that you got in your situation or your circumstances. So I just want you to invite you to Grace Works. If you want to be a part of our studio audience, just hit us up on Facebook. Let us know. If you got a story to tell about how Christ has brought you out, we would love for the world to know. Just let us know. If you'd like to be a part of our studio audience, hit us up. We just want to get it out there that Grace Works. People talking about a whole lot of things. People in homosexuality and different other things because they don't, and fornication and adultery, because they don't understand that Christ died for you. And there's absolutely nothing that you can do that will make him stop loving you, that will make him give up on you. You need to know that Grace Works. So I'm inviting you, your girl, this is your girl, Apostle Jacqueline Tisdale, inviting you to Grace Works. Just let us know. We would love to share your story. We bless you. We honor you. In Jesus Christ, have a great day. We would not want to let this show go without letting you know that no matter what you have gone through, you can be healed. You're looking at me on today. You're looking at a woman that has gone through so much. But today I can tell you I'm healed. I'm healed. I've forgiven everyone. And forgiveness is so key in walking in wholeness and in walking in healing. Well, I can't forgive them because you don't understand. Yeah, I do understand. But I didn't forgive them for them. I forgave them for me. And in the process of forgiving them, I was able to walk in wholeness. And another thing we have to learn to forgive is forgive ourselves. A lot of times we blame ourselves for the things that happen to us in life, like we were to blame. You cannot blame yourself for something somebody else decided to do to you. And I was talking to a family member here recently, and I was telling herself, she was blaming herself for a situation that she had nothing to do with. But I want God's people to know today, you don't have to blame yourself for anything. I'm telling you, you can walk in wholeness and you can walk in healing on today. I'm a living witness. I'm telling you, every day I fight to walk in forgiveness. I realize that the definition of forgiveness is to make room for error. And I realize that people are not perfect. So I don't expect them to be perfect in my life. But I'm telling you, I serve a perfect God that's able to make everything all right. So we're going to talk to Kelsey just a little bit more. And she want to talk to you how she began her healing process.
Well, I began my healing process when I knew that my life wasn't my own anymore. That I was here for a purpose. I really found out what my purpose was. And it was to do what God had me to do on earth. And the thing was, in the Bible, he said he had came that we may have life and life more abundant. So I knew that death wasn't an option. And that's when I started beginning my healing, as in forgiving myself, because it started with me first. I had to know that I'm forgiven to myself. And the thing is, I had to forgive others too, because like in the Bible, like he said, when he died on the cross, everything was finished. And he forgave all that hurted him. And I said, if I'm a child of him, I should be able to do the same. Mm-hmm. As forgive all that hurted me or all that I hurted. Or ask others to forgive me that I've hurt. And the thing is, I had to realize that when you don't forgive, you're being selfish. Because you're holding up your life. And mm-hmm. if you're holding up your life, you're holding up the people that is in line for you to help. Mm-hmm. So their life began to be held up. And I was like, Lord, I don't want to hold up anybody's life, so I know I got to get it right with you myself. And the thing is, I started beginning my healing, and the more I forgave, the more I felt brighter and brighter. I felt energy, and I felt like it was nothing to lose. Because I was like, if I had him, then that's all I can. He said, get more of him, and then everything else will be added to it. So I was like, well, then if all I got to do is just get more of him, then that's what I'm yearning for. So I need to put away my old self and become new. Like the Bible said, all things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. And I was like, Lord, I need a new heart, a new mindset, and a new, you know, a new everything that is not like you or whatever. And I said, because that's how people are going to be able to see their life. Like, you may have went through molested, rape, or even misused or mistreated or misunderstood. But in God's eyesight, you're perfect in Him. And that's all you got to know. As long as you're right with God, that nothing else matters. Because if we look for the next man to help us, you'll never be helped. And the thing is, you always have to look to God. And God is your answer and your key to everything. Like, even in your emotions and everything, like your moods. Like, he's the one that can control that. Nobody else. But if you're giving yourself the permission to let it happen, then it will happen. Because God said He give us a choice, and everything is in a choice. You got to have the faith to want to be able to be a forgiver, or you have to have the faith to even want to be changed. And once you have that faith enough, then God is ready to help you out. Because like He said, He's standing at the door knocking, and it's up to you to open. So you got to really open yourself up to God to do those changes, because you're not going to be able to do it in your own strength. And I had to find out that in my way, because my strength led me to something else. Mm-hmm. And God's strength led me towards Him. Mm-hmm. Like He said, He's standing there with His arms open wide. Mm-hmm. It's up to you. And I'm saying, if you need someone to hold you the way you're looking for it to be held, His arms are open. All you got to do is run to those arms. And be sure that it's the right arm that you're running to, because sometimes we'll hold ourselves back from things that we know we need, and it be right there. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you feel like you're at a point where you at your breaking point, but all you got to do is, Lord, I'm here. Here is your servant. Like, because the thing is, you got to understand, God is always there. He's never left you nor forsake you. Mm-hmm. And that's a promise that He kept. But the thing is, you got to keep your promise and say, Lord, for you I live, and for you I die. Mm-hmm. And for you I have my being. I breathe you. Thing is, you got to feel it within yourself.
That's it.
You can't feel it within somebody else telling you. You got to let yourself die, because if not, then yourself will rise and you'll think you're overpowering something that is really overpowering you.
That's good.
And God said, let me do the powering, and let my power show through you so that it can touch somebody else.
That's it.
And the thing is, I had to learn that nobody can be touched until I let God touch me.
And
the thing is, I said, Lord, if that's the touch that I'm yearning for, God, please let your hands stay among me, Lord Jesus, let it cover me. And I said, Lord, I don't need nobody to cover me in my nakedness, because you already shield me. And you're my umbrella from the rain. If it's a storm, Lord Jesus, I'm able to walk through it, because I know that yet do I walk through the shadow of death, I fear no evil, are with me.
That's it. That's it. That's
it. You just have to tell yourself,
that's it.
I will not let my storm control me.
That's it.
Jesus. It's a time in a day that I said cease, and it has to stop.
That's it. Come on, man.
It's just a storm, and sometimes your storm come tell some things, but Lord Jesus, let it tell the bad things. And Lord Jesus, you enter in the good things. That's what you tell God. You say, Lord Jesus, if a storm come now, I'm not going to be afraid. I'm not running for another shelter. I'm going to stand right here. And whatever it tell up. It's not meant for me. But everything that God has for you is meant for your good.
That's
all you have to do is tell yourself it's just a storm, and it will pass over. But it's until you figure out that God had already did the timing, and you fall in the place that He done.
Amen. Just know that it's a done deal in your life. Today, whoever is under the sound of our voices on today, I just want you to receive the healing of God right now. I just want you to receive His healing right now. That I can tell you on today, it's all right now. I hear the Lord saying, it's all right now. And I'm telling you, let the healing begin today. That you will go another day being so broken that you can't function. That you can't move forward in your life. I decree and declare over your life that the spell is broken today. Hallelujah. Oh, we honor God today for what he's done. Hallelujah. We bless God for you. And I just want somebody needs to know. Don't give up. Especially if you're a parent. If you're a mother, if you're a father, don't give up. Your child needs you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Your purpose, your purpose is to be there for your child. If that's the only thing you got to hold on to. I remember going through my first divorce, and the only thing that kept me holding on was not the fact that I loved God, and I did, but the fact that I had four children. I had three sons and a daughter that was looking at mama, that needed mama to be there. So I had to fight for them. So when I couldn't find strength in myself, I found strength for my kids. So don't you give up and don't you let go. Christ is right here. He's ready to heal you everywhere you hurt. This is your time. This is your season. Don't let it pass you by. Don't let it pass you by. Receive it on today. The church preaching about a whole lot of things, but have they got to your brokenness? Have they got to the root of the matter? It doesn't matter if I got money if I'm still broken. It doesn't matter if I got money and my house is tore up and I ain't got no peace of mind and I can't sleep at night. Because money can buy you a house, but it can't buy you a home. It can buy you a bed, but it cannot buy you sleep. I'm telling you, this is the hour. I thank God for Kelsey's testimony. I thank God for her words of wisdom. Because only when you learn how to go through, only learn when you learn how to endure the storms that keep raging. Raging, I'm telling you, sometimes the storm, it ain't no little storm, it rages. We look at all of the storms that's going on right now and all of the snow and all of it. It's raging, so it's coming to cause damage. But I'm telling you, like Paul said, if you just grab a hold to the broken pieces, my God, you can make it. Say, I'm making it. I might be on broken pieces, but I'm going to make it. Amen. And I believe in you. That's the reason grace work happens today. That's the reason we do it today, because we believe in you. I don't have to be your pastor to believe in you. I believe in the body of Christ. I believe in God's people. And I believe that God wants to bless his people. I'm telling you, show this to somebody that you know that's going through. Show it. If they're going to have it posted, they're going to have it posted on the website, they're going to have it posted on YouTube. I want to put it out there. I'm telling you, when you hit your page, share it. Because somebody needs to know that it's all right now.
And it's not about your age.
Come on.
Because I'm only 24. And I went through it I was married twice, and I got married at the age of 19. So it's not about your age, whether you can go through it or not. It's just your strength in God.
That's it. That's what it's about. So we're going to ask Kelsey. I want her to just minister to the people just for a few minutes and just want to pray for them and pray for their healing and pray for their deliverance. Amen?
Okay. Father God, I ask that you touch each and everyone's heart out there that has been broken and been just mistreated and been misused, or they may have thought they've been misused or treated. Lord Jesus, I ask that you put your hand among them, Lord Jesus, and keep your arms open for them to run to, God. Lord Jesus, you said that we have the key to all things, God. Let them know that they have the key to life and life more abundantly. They have the key to their success. They have the key to their changing. They have the key to the faith and the hope and the peace. God, they have the key to grace. Because grace had came and kept us. That's because you said once you died on the cross, it was finished. So Lord Jesus, you said you chase us after the ones that are chosen, God. Let them know that they're chosen for this season. And Lord Jesus, let them know that their storm will pass over. Mm-hmm. And Lord Jesus, that you have everything they need. And Lord Jesus, let them call for everything that they need, Lord Jesus. Let them know that you are here and not here just to be here. And Lord Jesus, let them know that grace doesn't just work for the ones in the church. You may not be a person that's up under a leader, but grace will still work for you. And it will get you into a position to where you find someone that can cover you in your nakedness. Because everything that you're going through is just a test for somebody else to come out. And I ask that God let you be able to reveal your test when it's due time. And when you're ready to reveal your test, that you walk away from it completely and be whole and not be broken anymore. That your heart may be reconstructed and that your heart may be healed. That your heart may not feel the old things. And that you'll be able to be so new that whatever you went through, that somebody else will be able to follow behind and be able to say, I will no longer live a life I used to live. And the Lord Jesus, just let them be encouraged that you are God and God alone. No one else. No man, no walking under the law anymore. That we're walking under grace. Mm-hmm. And that the man said you can't be healed. But God said you are healed.
Come on, man.
So Lord Jesus, let them know that everything that you said is not a lie.
That's
and it don't return back void.
That's it.
And Lord Jesus, that they can write the check and be able to cash it at the same time. Lord Jesus, I just ask that you touch them and let them know we are living in the time of abundance. Jesus.
Come on,
and not poverty. We don't have to settle for less. Because less is abundant, our best. And Lord Jesus, we're going to put on our best work now. And Lord Jesus, don't be ashamed to walk around with the mess, because your mess is your best day ahead. And Lord Jesus, just walk straight and keep one foot ahead. And like T.D. Jakes, I remember what he said. He said, pause on your step, because at the same time, when you walking straight, you're going to pause and let them know, this is the life I used to live. But once I take another step, you'll never see that life again. So now you got your best day ahead.
My
and God said, be healed in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Jesus.
Yes,
amen. 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 Be healed. That's
yes,
all
Lord.
I said.
Yes, Lord.
I'm telling you, all you got to do is receive it. The word of God, all you got to do is receive it.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank God for it. Amen. We thank God
Jesus
for letting the healing begin on today. Amen. 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 We thank God for a great show. Come on, let's give it up. Amen. This is your girl, Apostle Jacqueline Tisdale. Amen. Minister Kelsey Parker is in the house. Amen. We're going to see great things from this young lady. I believe that the best has yet began in her life. Amen. I'm telling you what, there was shame, but God shall give her double for her trouble. Amen. I'm telling you, you don't know why a person got in a situation area, but we thank God for a deliverer that's going to bring us out. Amen. It's your brother, Apostle Jacqueline Tisdale. We thank you for tuning in to Grace Work. See you the next time. God bless.